Hi, I'm Dan Petrick, the Lake and River Shoreland Program Manager for the Minnesota Department of Natural Resources. Today, we're going to cover why and how we regulate bluffs and shoreland. Regulating bluffs and identifying the location of bluffs and shoreland is one of the most technically challenging aspects of local government regulation. I'm hoping that after today's training, you'll have more comfort and be better able to explain why and how we regulate bluffs and shoreland. Also, a lot of what we'll cover today also applies to bluffs in the critical area located within the Twin Cities area, as well as the Wild and Scenic and Lower St. Croix Riverway areas. The Lower St. Croix and the Wild and Scenic regulations around bluffs are not nearly as robust as those in the shoreland and the critical area, and I'll cover those differences at the end of this training. Today, we're going to start out by reviewing why we have bluff protections in the Shoreland District, then briefly go through the key bluff regulations, and lastly, we'll work through a bluff definition example using topographic data. As zoning administrators, you understand that it's always helpful to be able to explain why we have certain regulations to property owners who may not always appreciate the regulation. In this first part, we'll talk about the various reasons we regulate development on and around bluffs and shoreland. Well, the first reason is to reduce the risk of slope failure. Land around our lakes and rivers includes a wide variety of underlying rock, soil types, and steepness. In certain combinations, especially when soils are saturated, slopes start to move downhill, sometimes failing catastrophically, risking damage to or loss of property, as we see here. Additionally, the shoreland bluff standards also work to minimize erosion and nutrient flow into surface waters. While not all erosion problems are this severe, any sediment moving into our waters accelerates the growth of algae and harms aquatic habitat, fish, amphibians, and waterfowl. And lastly, the bluff standards work to maintain visual quality and habitat by keeping structures behind ridge lines. Now, let's look at the specific regulations that apply on and around bluffs. The key bluff regulation that addresses all of these purposes is the requirement that structures, as well as roads, parking areas, and driveways, be set back from the top of a bluff by 30 feet. On the screen is what a typical survey might look like where a bluff has been delineated by a professional surveyor. Using the bluff and top of bluff definitions, the surveyor has identified the top of bluff. From the top of bluff line, one can then measure 30 feet in the direction of desired building area and identify the structure setback. Here is where the structure can be built. All other bluff regulations within the local ordinances limit uses and activities in an area called the bluff impact zone. So we need to know what that is. In this side profile, you can see that a bluff impact zone, or BIZ, is the bluff itself from the toe to the top and 20 feet from the top. Together, this area is known as the bluff impact zone. Within the bluff impact zone, shoreline regulations prohibit structures, feedlots, farming, or intensive vegetation clearing. In this image, a stairway and an electric lift is shown as an allowable use in the BIZ. However, it looks like much of this BIZ was clear-cut, a violation of the prohibition on intensive vegetation clearing. Land alteration is allowed in the BIZ. However, any alteration disturbing more than 10 cubic yards requires a permit and best management practices for minimizing impacts. However, it's important to remember that intensive vegetation clearing is not allowed in the BIZ, so one could not alter land if it involves intensive vegetation removal first. In this photo, we have soil disturbance clearly exceeding 10 cubic yards, so a permit would definitely be required. It also looks likely that vegetation was cleared before the land alteration activity began. And if so, that would be another violation. Okay, so let's move on to the technical task of applying the bluff definitions to a specific slope feature to determine if we actually have a bluff. All local shoreland ordinances should have four bluff-related definitions. Let's look at them one at a time. First is the bluff definition itself. This definition is a series of four sequential criteria. All four must be met for there to be a bluff. If one isn't true, then there's no bluff. In a moment, we'll come back to this definition and look at each of these individual criteria. The next bluff-related definition is the toe of bluff. This definition is referenced in the fourth item of the bluff definition, so we'll need to apply the toe of bluff definition for determining if we have a bluff. Next is the top of bluff definition. You'll note that the top of bluff and the toe of bluff are very similar definitions, the only difference being whether you are looking for the lower or higher point of a 50-foot segment. The last definition is the bluff impact zone, which we've just looked at. Note that you do not need to find the top of bluff to determine if you have a bluff. The top of bluff and bluff impact zone definitions are only applicable after determining that a bluff exists. If you don't have a bluff, then there's no need to find the top or the bluff impact zone. So now let's go through each of the four parts of the bluff definition. The first item asks, is part or all of the slope feature located in shoreland? This graphic reminds us that shoreland is 1,000 feet from the ordinary high water level of a lake and 300 feet from the top of a riverbank, shown here in green. If there are any potential bluffs partially located in shoreland or the green zone, we still need to evaluate them. If they meet the bluff definition, we would then apply the relevant bluff regulations to that part of the bluff located in shoreland. For example, if the lower part of a bluff is located in shoreland but the upper part is not, one could not intensely remove vegetation from the lower part that is in shoreland, but you could in the upper part that is not in shoreland. Removing vegetation from the top of bluff isn't a good idea, but it wouldn't be a violation of the shoreland ordinance. The next item in the bluff definition asks, does the slope drain towards the water body? This doesn't mean that the runoff must reach the water body, just that the runoff of any rainfall would naturally drain towards the water body. In this example, you can see that runoff doesn't always have to flow in a straight line to the water body, just that it drain towards it. Now that we've covered the first two parts of the bluff definition, I'm going to use a series of animations to go through item three. Does the slope rise 25 feet above the ordinary high? And item four, does the grade of the slope from the toe to a point 25 feet or more above the ordinary high, average 30% or more. To help with this bluff determination, I'm using LiDAR elevation data for a specific parcel of land that I downloaded from MinTopo. MinTopo is an online application for viewing and downloading elevation data, and if you haven't used it yet, I strongly encourage you to check it out. I created the slope profile here using an Excel-based bluff profile tool, which is available for download from our bluff resources page. Now, according to criterion number three in the bluff definition, a bluff is a slope that rises at least 25 feet above the ordinary high. In this case, the ordinary high is at 1,050 feet, and 25 feet above this is 1,075 feet. We can see that this slope feature meets criterion three, and the slope does indeed rise at least 25 feet above the ordinary high. Now, moving on to criterion number four, the bluff definition states that the grade from the toe to a point 25 feet or more above the ordinary high is 30% or more. So there are a few things here we need to unpack in this statement. First, we need to find the toe. When a slope rises directly from the water, the ordinary high and the toe are the same. But if the slope rises at some distance away from the water, such as this example, you need to find the toe. And to do that, we need to look at the toe of bluff definition. The toe is the lower point of a 50-foot segment with an average slope exceeding 18%. Here's our 50-foot segment. And whether one is doing a physical survey or working in this bluff profile tool, you need to move this 50-foot segment up and down the slope until you find the sweet spot where the slope percentage is just slightly over 18%, which I've done here. The lower end of this 50-foot segment with a slope just over 18% is our toe of slope. We can return to criterion number four now and evaluate the slope from the toe, which we just found, to the point 25 feet or more above the ordinary high. And we can see that the slope is 33%. It's over 30%, so we now know that we now have a bluff. The next step is to locate the top of bluff. Now, if you look at the top of bluff definition, you'll notice that it's almost the same as the toe, except now we're looking for the higher point of a 50-foot segment that exceeds 18% instead of the lower point of a 50-foot segment. By applying the definition to find the top, we find the top in the same way we found the toe. Now that we know the top of bluff location, we can measure 20 feet beyond the top to find the bluff impact zone, or BIZ, which, as we've mentioned already, is the bluff and 20 feet from the top. So having identified the 20-foot, the last part of this exercise is to find the 30-foot setback from the top of bluff and place our structure at the behind that setback. And there you have it. This is the basic process for finding a bluff. Before we finish about locating a bluff, I want to mention the bluff exemption provision that is an unnumbered provision in the bluff definition. This provision was designed to allow relatively flat areas between the top of a bluff and the toe of a bluff to be developed by exempting them from being part of the bluff. This provision rarely applies, but when it does, structures must still meet water and bluff setbacks. I want you to be aware of this exemption definition because some property owners and surveyors confuse this definition with a similar definition for the toe and top, and thus rationalize the removal of land that is technically the toe or the top of the bluff from the bluff evaluation, resulting often in a determination that there is no bluff. Note the similarities between these definitions. With the bluff exemption definition, we're talking about an area, though, with an average slope less than 18% over a 50-foot distance. For both the toe and top of bluff definitions, it's an area that exceeds 18% over a distance of 50 feet. When working with property owners and surveyors who want to use this exemption for a no bluff determination, remind them that it can only apply between designated toe and top of bluff locations. It's also helpful to remind them of its purpose, to allow development on terraces within large bluff complexes, which are relatively rare in Minnesota. Before exploring our online resources, I want to briefly show you how the Shoreland program compares to the river-related programs on bluff-related definitions and standards. Some of you work with these other program areas, and it's helpful to know how they differ. The Shoreland and Mississippi River critical area programs are very similar in that they have quantifiable parameters to more precisely locate bluffs. They both specify a height and or a horizontal distance over which a given slope percent is applied. Either the Wild and Scenic River or Lower St. Croix programs use quantifiable parameters, and thus determining a bluff in these areas is a bit more of an art. I also want to point out that there are no toe and top of bluff definitions or a bluff impact zone for either the Wild and Scenic or Lower St. Croix programs. And before wrapping up, I'd just like to briefly show you our Bluff and Slope Protections website. Here you can find bluff resources and tools for understanding bluffs and administering bluff regulations. There are three documents I do want to point out that are found on this page. First is a guidance document called Identifying Bluffs in Shoreland. This is essential reading if you really want to understand how to identify bluffs in shoreland. All the information I've been talking about has been covered in this document, but this document goes over it in much more detail. I also want to point out our quick guide for analyzing slopes using MnTopo. If you've never used MnTopo before, check out this document and learn how to use MnTopo. We think that this is a great approach, or at least a first starting step, to find out if you think you have a bluff. If it looks like there might be a bluff using the tools within MnTopo, you could then move on to the next guidance piece that we have here, which is our Bluff Profile tool, which is an Excel-based tool to help you precisely locate toe and top of bluff features. This tool does take a fair amount of time to learn how to use and download data from MnTopo. But once you do learn it, you'll find it helpful for explaining bluff locations to your public or even in your elected officials in situations where bluff determination is a bit complex or possibly controversial. So that's it. Thank you very much, and I hope this training helps increase your understanding of the bluff definition and your comfort with finding bluff features and administering the Bluff standards.